The Devil's Greatest Deception Affecting You, Part 2. Now, we spent a fair amount of time last night on Part 1, and my guess is that some of you at some point were thinking, now wait a second, I thought this was a prophecy seminar. But I hope that you saw, we made the tie, and we're going to make that tie in even stronger in this particular presentation. Because what we looked at last night, make no mistake, it makes the indispensable foundation for what we're going to talk about here from here on out. We are building block by block, putting in the pieces of this puzzle so that we can understand what God's will is for us in these last days. We're building up towards identifying the mark of the beast, working our way, putting all those pieces together. So stay with us. We have some excellent things we want to share with you here in the Prophecies of Hope seminar. Now, you will remember that when we started this seminar, I made you a promise, actually several of them, and one of those promises was that if I was going to present my opinion, I would tell you about it, and you can do whatever you want with my opinion because it's just my opinion, but that we instead were going to spend most of our time on God's opinion, God's Word as found in this book. And I've done my best to do that, and tonight we are going to look at some truths from God's Word that are frankly astonishing. Truths that have been long forgotten, but they are oh so relevant for today. I want to begin by looking at that message. We've already looked at it a couple of times here, but let's pull something new out of it this time. Revelation chapter 14, beginning with verse 6. It's on, page number. Someone's going to have to tell me what that page number is. 1183. Yes, there we go. Revelation chapter 14. 6 through 10, and I'll tell you what, for the sake of speed and efficiency, let me put it up here on the screen. Revelation 14, 6 to 10, John says, "And I saw another angel fly in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to preach unto them that dwell on the earth, and to every nation and kindred and tongue and people, saying with a loud voice, Fear God, and give glory to him, for the hour of his judgment is come, and worship him that made heaven and earth and the sea and the fountains of waters." And there followed another angel, this is angel number two, saying, Babylon is fallen, that great city, because she made all the nations drink of the wine of the wrath of her fornication. And then comes the third angel. The third angel followed them, saying with a loud voice, If any man worship the beast in his image and receive his mark in his forehead or in his hand, the same shall drink of the wine of the wrath of God, which is poured out without mixture into the cup of his indignation. And he shall be tormented with fire and brimstone in the presence of the holy angels and in the presence of the Lamb. It started with, and worship him that made heaven and earth, the sea, and the fountains of waters. Now, you'll remember that we talked about these three angels' messages as being extremely important. In fact, we said they are the main reason that the book of Revelation was written. You'll recall that there's all kinds of important things here in the book of Revelation, but because of the Jewish mindset, particularly in the context of Jewish apocalyptic literature, which Revelation falls into that category, it is what is in the middle thematically of the book that is most important. That is the three angels' messages. So these are very, very important. And it begins there in that first angel again, and worship him that made heaven and earth, the sea and the fountain of waters. You know, this phrase from verse 7, it directs our attention clearly to the subject of worship. In fact, it is no exaggeration to say that the issue in the book of Revelation, and thus the issue in the end of time, is worship. And what is this worship issue all about? Well, it is the issue that's clearly highlighted here in Revelation 14, 7 on the one hand, and then verse 9 later on. People will either choose to worship the Creator, that's Him who made, or they will choose to worship the beast. Now, the entire world, including me, including you, will be on one side or the other. Take a look at this here, Revelation 13, 1 to 3. Just a reminder of where we've been, set the stage here. It says, John says, And I stood upon the sand of the sea, and I saw a beast rise up out of the sea, having seven heads and ten horns, and upon his horns 10 crowns, and upon his heads the name of blasphemy. And the beast which I saw was like unto a leopard, and his feet were as the feet of a bear, and his mouth as the mouth of a lion. And the dragon gave him his power and his seat and great authority. And I saw one of his heads as if it had been wounded to death, and his deadly wound was healed, and all the world wondered after the beast. Down to verse 8, And all that dwell upon the earth shall worship him, those whose names are not written in the book of life of the Lamb, slain from the foundation of the world. Now, there it is quite clearly portrayed. All the world is shown to be worshiping and following the beast. Now, if you were at our bonus session this morning, you know that, as we said there, clearly this excludes those that follow Jesus Christ. They are not being referred to here as people that are bowing down to the beast, worshiping him, etc. But the Bible also makes it clear that the vast majority of the planet will be, that they will be following and worshiping the beast. Well, we've spent a great deal of time together, and we've already learned what this beast represents. Now, for those of you that may have missed some of those presentations, if you're new tonight, we welcome you, and we trust that you can absorb what we are going to discuss. I want to really encourage you, if you're new, before you leave this evening, check out in the lobby. We have a table there that has printed copies of previous presentations. Be sure and get that material. You'll recall that we discovered that the beast, this Antichrist beast, is represented by, represents the Roman Church, otherwise known as the papacy. And indeed, in the last days, its powerful reach will once again become global. Consequently, if today we find an area in which all the world follows the beast instead of the Bible, it should not surprise us because God has told us this is what it will be like in the end. Now follow me carefully here. Since the message of Revelation 14:7 says to worship him that made heaven and earth, and remember, this is a core message. This is key for people living right in our day. It says worship him that made heaven and earth. Let's go back to the beginning when God did indeed make everything and read about it so we can understand what's coming in Bible prophecy. Genesis 1, verse 1, and it is on page 1 in your prophecy seminar Bible. Genesis 1, verse 1. Here's what it says. It says, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Now, if we were to continue reading on here, we would indeed find the story of creation. It gives us quite a bit of detail. It goes on even on into chapter 2. If we were to keep reading, we would discover that on the first day, you can see here the days of creation kind of symbolized here by these obelisks. The first day, he created light. The second day, he created air. The third day, water and vegetation. Fourth day, the sun, moon, and stars. Fifth day, birds and fish. And on the sixth days, animals and the crowning act of physical creation, man and woman. Now here in Genesis 1, therefore, we have the first 6 days of the history of the world. Now, maybe you've done a big project sometime. Maybe you've done a remodel at your house or built something, did a flower bed out in the yard. And at the end of it, don't you kind of stand back sometimes and you make kind of a proclamation? Well, this is what God does. Look at Genesis 1, verse 31. It says, then God saw everything that he had made, and indeed it was very good. God's pretty pleased with what he's done. Which brings us to the seventh day of that very first week. The very first seventh day in the history of the world. Genesis 2, verses 1 through 3. Says, thus the heavens and the earth and all the host of them were finished. And on the seventh day God ended his work which he had done, and he rested on the seventh day from all his work which he had done. Then God blessed the seventh day and sanctified it, because in it he rested from all his work which God had created and made. Now notice carefully, the Bible says that after he finished, God finished the work of creation, he pronounces it very good, and then the pronouncement is not sufficient. There's something more that needs to be done. And so he creates, get this, a holy day and sets it aside as a memorial of his creation. That is what the text says. He blessed this day and he sanctified it. And just so that we're clear, this is why he did it. Look at verse 3. Then God blessed the seventh day and sanctified it because, here it comes, because in it he rested from all his work which God had created and made. You see, it is not only a holy day, it is also a holiday. Now, in the United States, we have quite a few holidays, not near as many as some other countries in the world do, but you know what the purpose of a holiday is, right? I mean, like, as in an official holiday. It is designated as a day to remember something. Well, in much the same way, God gives us the seventh-day Sabbath as a way to remember his works of creation. Psalm 111, 2-4 speaks to this. The works of the Lord, it says, are great. sought out of all them that have pleasure therein. His work is honorable and glorious, and his righteousness endureth forever. He hath made his wonderful works to be, what? To be remembered. The Lord is gracious and full of compassion. Now, this is not an ego trip. This is not that the Lord has made some trophy case saying, look, look, look at me. Ain't I great? This is God telling the truth. You see, when we remember that he is great, when we remember his glorious creation, it's best for us. It's good for us. It is a blessing to us. Did you know that God is so concerned that we remember his creative power that he actually writes it in the center of his Ten Commandment law? Commandment number 4, Exodus 20, verses 8 to 11. Here's what it says. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. Why don't we read this one together? Let's try this. Ready? 1, 2, 3. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days shalt thou labor and do all thy work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord thy God. In it you shall do no work. You, nor your son, nor your daughter, nor your male servant, nor your female servant, nor your cattle, nor your stranger who is within your gates. For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, the sea, and all that is in them, and rested the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and hallowed it. Now, did you notice the clear, crystal clear connection between this fourth commandment and what we read earlier in Revelation 14, verse 7? Do you remember that we said that the majority, not even just a little portion, the majority of texts that are found in the book of Revelation come from other places in Scripture? Well, this is one of them. The first angel's message, this first of the three, this most important portion of the book of Revelation, and it begins with this message that includes, and worship him who made. What did the commandment say? For in 6 days God made the heavens and the earth. The first angel's message, the message for this day, is directly referring back to the fourth commandment of God's Ten Commandment law. God is calling attention back to this particular commandment. Now, why does he do this? Well, let's think about it. On what basis does God have the authority to tell humanity how they ought to live? Okay. What right does God have to give us the Ten Commandments and ask us to keep them? Keeps coming back, doesn't it? Since the last days involve this issue of worship, let's ask another question. What right does God have to ask for our worship? It's the same answer, isn't it? There's only one answer. It's because he is our creator. God made everything. He made the earth. He made me. He made you. And that is what gives him the authority. If he were not the creator, he would not have these rights. In fact, listen closely. This is extremely important. To say that God is creator is the most important thing that we can say about him. It is absolutely top of the list, hands down. I will take a Bible in hand and we can debate this as long as you wish to, because this is so, so, so very key. To say that God is creator is the most important thing we can say about him. It is more important than saying that he is our redeemer. You say, are you saying that it's not important for him to be a redeemer? No, I'm not saying that at all. It's very important. But to say that he's creator is more important. How do I know? Because my Bible tells me so. The psalmist said, talking to God, he says, create in me a clean heart and renew a right spirit within me. Only the creator can be the redeemer, because salvation is an act of creation. You follow me? Only the creator can save me. Only the creator can save you. This is why the devil's cause is lost from the beginning. He may say, oh no, follow me and I'll take you wherever you want to go. He can't save you. He's not a creative being. He hasn't created anything. Everything he does is derived from something else that someone else made. But God is the creator. And it's the foundation of everything else, including the cross of Jesus Christ. So no wonder the first portion of God's final message to the planet before he returns includes a strong focus on him as the creator. Everything hinges upon that. Add to that that you can read the Ten Commandments from start to finish, and you will find only one commandment that explicitly identifies God as the creator. It's commandment number 4. Now, by the way, now might be a good time to ask this. Which day of the week does the commandment identify as the Sabbath? What does the commandment say? Okay, the seventh day. Now, what day is the seventh day? Okay, Saturdays, that's true. Now, how do we know that? I'll give you two sources. You see Brother Webster here on the screen. Webster's dictionary, it says Saturday, you can see it there, the seventh day of the week. Now, that's fairly straightforward, isn't it? But more importantly, we can also look to the Bible, because three of the most famous days in history will clearly tell us which day is the Sabbath. Take a look at page 1023. Luke 23, verse 50. Luke chapter 23, verse 50, and we're going to read it through verse 54. The scene is this. Jesus is on the cross. He has just died. He has just died on the cross. And there is a man that is usually referred to as Joseph of Arimathea. He was a wealthy person. He was a wealthy Jew. And he is going to do something here. Verse 50. It says, "Now behold, there was a man named Joseph, a council member, a good and just man. He had not consented to their decision and deed," in other words, consented to the choice of the Jewish rulers to crucify Christ. "He," Joseph, "was from Arimathea, a city of the Jews, who himself was also waiting for the kingdom of God. This man went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Then he took it down, wrapped it in linen, and laid it in a tomb that was hewn out of the rock, where no one had ever lain before. That day was the preparation, and the Sabbath drew near." So notice what he says here. The day that Jesus died on was the preparation day. Now, which day did Jesus die on? What day of the week? Okay, Friday. That's why so many people celebrate, they call it Good Friday. Okay? Now, let's keep reading here. Look at verse 55 and 56. "And the women who had come with him," that is Jesus, "from Galilee followed after, and they observed the tomb and how his body was laid. Then they returned and prepared spices and fragrant oils, and they rested on the," which day? "Sabbath, according to the commandment." The text is very clear. The women, they rest on Sabbath, and this is the day that follows the preparation day, which we've already said that was Friday. So therefore, which day of the week was the Sabbath? Saturday. That's what happens. Friday, Saturday. Now, Luke 24, verse 1. "Now on the first day of the week, very early in the morning, they and certain other women with them came to the tomb, bringing the spices which they had prepared. But they found the stone rolled away from the tomb. Then they went in and did not find the body of the Lord Jesus." How come? Because he had risen from the grave. So the verse here very clearly says that Jesus rose from the grave very early on the first day of the week. So what day did Jesus rise from the grave? On Sunday, okay? Now, this is a basic step here. The first day is referred to as the preparation time, or the preparation day. Saturday is referred to as the Sabbath, and Sunday is referred to as the first day of the week. Now, you're probably thinking, duh. And if it sounds elementary to you, that should be no surprise, because it couldn't be more clear. Saturday is the Sabbath, the seventh day of the week. But if you're tracking like I think some of you are tracking, suddenly what seems so simple is given a measure of complexity. You might be wondering this: if Saturday is the seventh day of the week, then why do most Christians keep Sunday? Some of you might be thinking, "No, wait a second, I thought this whole thing with the seventh day was the Jewish Sabbath. I mean, that was something that was done for the Jews, not for Christians." And some of you might be thinking, "Well, okay, that's all fine and well, but you know, does it really matter what day we keep? Isn't one day just as good as the other?" You know, these are excellent questions, and so we're going to get some answers to them this evening. And remember, let's just not use just mere human opinions or reasoning. Let's get some answers from the Bible. So let's start with this idea of the seventh day being for the Jews, a Jewish Sabbath. Let's do a little review here. How many people were on planet Earth on the sixth day of creation? Two. Low population. Census workers had short jobs in those days, okay? Their names were Adam and Eve, right? Sixth day. When was the Sabbath created? Okay, on the seventh day. That's right. Now, were Adam and Eve Jews? No. In fact, there were no Jews for hundreds of years after that time. Not a one. If you had mentioned the word to them, they would say, Who's that? Because there were no Jews in that time. Now, this is clearly pointed out. Look at Mark chapter 2, please, verse 27, page 970 in your Prophecy Seminar Bible, 970. Mark chapter 2, verse 27, and we're going to read verse 28 as well. Jesus here once again is having a run-in with the Jewish religious rulers. Those were not always positive interactions. Verse 27, and he, Jesus, said to them, "The Sabbath was made for Jews." Wait. You know, I just got these new glasses, and so I'm trying to figure them out a little bit here. It says, "The Sabbath was made for who?" For man. And the Greek word there means people. It means humanity. That's what it means. That's why it's translated here like this. It says, "The Sabbath was made for man, for mankind, and not man for the Sabbath. Therefore, the Son of Man is also Lord of the Sabbath." Huh. The Sabbath was not made for the Jews, Jesus here. It's made for people. In fact, God never made the Sabbath for the Jews. In fact, nowhere in the Bible is the seventh day called the Sabbath of the Jews. It was instead made, well, first for Adam and Eve, and then for every other human being who ever lived. Remember, the Sabbath is a memorial to God's creative power. And who did God create? All people. He is the creator of all. It's obviously, therefore, not just for the Jews. It cannot be. Now, what about this idea that any day is a good day to keep the Sabbath just so long as you keep it sometime? Well, you remember what we said. We looked all the way back in the book of Genesis. You don't need to turn there. I'll let my fingers do the walking for you here. He said in the beginning, he says, "Thus the heavens and the earth and all the host of them were finished. And on the seventh day, God ended his work which he had done. And he rested on the seventh day from all his work which he had done. Then God blessed the seventh day and sanctified it, because in it he rested from all his work which God had created and made." Notice carefully the three things that God did to specifically set apart the seventh day. He rested on it, he blessed it, and he sanctified it. That is, he made it holy. He set it apart for a sacred use. Now, make sure we understand this here. This idea of making something holy, can you make something holy? Can I make something holy? No, there's no person on earth, there's no committee, there's no church, it doesn't matter how good you may think you are, you cannot make something holy, because you cannot give away something you do not innately have. Only the one who is innately holy, by definition holy, can make something else holy, and that one is God. Only God can make something holy. And so we come here, and God is looking, you know, day one, day two, day three, four, five, six, and he comes to day seven, and this is the one. This is the one that God said, "I am going to bless this day, and I'm going to sanctify it, I'm going to make it holy." God did not do this to any other day. Now notice why he does this. What is the purpose? Let's read the full command. You know this commandment, Exodus 20. I want you to see this in your own Bible. If you don't already have it marked there, I want you to see it. Look at Exodus 20, please. We're going to read it quickly, but I want you to see this with your own eyes. This is crucial stuff here. Exodus 20, beginning with verse 8, says again, "Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work." Verse 10, "But the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord your God. In it you shall do no work, you, nor your son, nor your daughter, nor your male servant, nor your female servant, nor your cattle, nor your stranger that who is within your gates. For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, the sea, and all that is in them, and rested the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and hallowed it." Now, we discovered last time that we were together that this is the only portion of Scripture, these Ten Commandments. It's the only portion of Scripture that God himself writes with his own finger. And when God was writing the fourth commandment, what's the first word that he used? Remember. Think of it this way. When I leave the house in the morning and my wife says to me, "Remember to pick up some milk on the way home." Why does she tell me to remember? Because she knows me. You know, we've been married for 20 plus years. In fact, next week is going to be 22nd anniversary coming up here. And she does indeed know that I can forget, that I'm going to go and get something. So she says, "Hey, pick that up on the way home." She thinks I might forget. Well, guess what? God here says, "Remember." How come? Because he knew, especially after the fall, that we would be prone to forget. And it is astonishing that in the only one of the Ten Commandments where God has said, "Remember," it seems that most of the world has forgotten. You know, I want to suggest to you that we need a Sabbath more today than ever before. You know, people are under the gun 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, and yet God created us, and He knows, because He's our Creator, that we need rest. But there's a greater reason beyond just physical rest that God gave us the Sabbath. You see, more than anything else, when it comes to us, God wants to build a relationship with us. And if there's one thing we can agree upon, I hope it's this: any relationship, if it's going to grow, needs time. You see, God wants to spend time with you. Now think about that for a moment. Those of you that are married, do you remember back when you were dating? Time was such a bear back then, wasn't it? You just hated to spend time with your girlfriend or your boyfriend, right? It was awful. You see them coming down the hallway, and you'd walk into a classroom just to get out of the way of seeing them again, wouldn't you? Right? It was awful. I have to spend all this time, right? You know, is that how it was? No, that's not how it was at all. It was like, when are you done with your next class, right? If you're still in school when you're dating, you know, okay, I'll meet you there right at the door. We'll go out in front campus, then we'll meet at the cafeteria for lunch, et cetera, et cetera. And all of this time, it comes easy because, you know what? There's something intuitive inside the human heart that knows that if there's going to be a genuine relationship, it's going to take time. Well, God wants to spend time with you. He wants to spend time with me. In God's date book, every week, it's got your name in it. Now, it's not that God only spends time with us on the Sabbath, but I'll tell you what, there's nothing else like the Sabbath throughout the rest of the week. There's no other day like it. God said, okay, this one's different. I'm going to bless it. I'm going to sanctify it. I want 24 hours with you. I want to spend 24 hours. You can stop all the other stuff. Now, some people look at the prohibition against work. Sometimes I think maybe kids and teens may think this, oh, man, stuff I can't do. And the adults are like, oh, praise the Lord, I don't have to work today. And we have time. We can stop. We can get out of the rat race for 24 hours and just be with God. That is awesome. To think that the God of the universe wants to spend time with me, with you, every single week, special time set aside. It's one of the biggest reasons God created the Sabbath. And sadly, it is one of the reasons that the devil hates God's Sabbath. It is the commandment that he has attacked more than any other because he knows what will happen if you do spend time with Jesus. Why? You'll get to know him. You'll find out that he loves you beyond comprehension. You will find things in him to love. You'll become more like him. You will become the devil's worst nightmare if you spend time with Jesus. So no wonder he picks on the Sabbath so much. There's still another reason that the devil hates the Sabbath. Did you know that the Sabbath, the seventh-day Sabbath, keeping it holy, observing it, it is a sign of our love relationship with Jesus? Now, I want you to see this straight from the Bible. Look at Ezekiel chapter 20, verse 20. It's page 819. Page 819, Ezekiel 20, verse 20. We have not yet been in Ezekiel, so I am glad that at last we are coming here. Now, Ezekiel is actually the book from which Revelation quotes the most. There's just a great deal of commonality here between Revelation and Ezekiel. We're just going to read a little snippet here. Ezekiel 20, verse 20. God here is speaking, and he's going to talk about the Sabbath. Here's what he says, page 819. He says, "Hallow my Sabbaths." In other words, keep them holy. "And they will be a sign between me and you that you may know that I am the Lord your God." Wow. Let that sink in here. What he's saying is that if you keep the seventh-day Sabbath holy, it is like this billboard that proclaims to God and the onlooking world, "I believe there is a God and that he is my God." I mean, that's what it says here. This is a sign that they may know that I am the Lord your God. In other words, this is a witness. It is a sign that you believe in God, that your trust is in him, that you're following him, that he is your redeemer and your friend. It's a sign to everyone else that cares to look, I am a follower of Jesus Christ. And you know, the opposite also is true. To not keep the Sabbath holy when we understand it and know it, to not keep that Sabbath holy, to treat it like any other day, is to say that he is not our God. It is to say that he is not who he claims to be, the Creator. It is to say that we are not in a relationship with him. And by extension, what's the implication? Neither should you. Neither should you. I tell you, God has packed powerful meaning into this thing that he calls the Sabbath. God has said, keep my Sabbath holy. They're going to be a sign between the two of us, 24 hours, in this special relationship that we have. Now you tell me, do you think the devil knows the meaning of the Sabbath? Yeah, I think he does. Unfortunately, he reads his Bible. In fact, every time God has given us a blessing, the devil has come up with a counterfeit. That's his trademark. Again, the devil is not creative. In fact, if you really stop and think about it, sin is the most boring thing you could do. There's nothing creative about it. It's completely derivative. God himself has made the true, and the devil comes along and says, okay, I like that, I like that, I like that, and let me put my little twist on here. And he comes up with a counterfeit. Very uncreative. That's his trademark. God gives the Sabbath, and the devil knows that the Sabbath honors God as the Creator above all the other commandments, and so in order to detract from the worship of the true God and hopefully nullify, he thinks, anything that might honor God, he has twisted things so much today that most of the sincere Christian world is breaking the Sabbath day and they don't even know it. And so God in his mercy sends us the truth. We can see here that the Sabbath commandment is yet another reason why the devil teaches that the law has been done away with. And yet, interestingly enough, have you noticed, you may have noticed this previously when we were talking about this, most people who teach that the law of God has been done away with still keep 9 out of 10. Have you noticed that? To be honest, I've met many, many Christians that have said the law of God is done away with. But I've never really met one that said, that means I can just kill everybody. They don't say that. In fact, if you go down the list, yeah, those 9, they're pretty strong on those things still. But commandment number 4 bothers them. And in an effort to set aside that 4th commandment, too often, too many of them try to do away with the entire law. Now, you'll remember we read some texts about that. If that is the case, let's get a reminder here about how God feels about breaking part of his law. Look at James chapter 2 again, page 1159. Page 1159. James chapter 2, verses 10 to 12. He says, "For whoever shall keep the whole law and yet stumble in one point, he is guilty of all. For he who said, 'Do not commit adultery,' also said, 'Do not murder.' Now, if you do not commit adultery, but you do murder, you have become a transgressor of the law. So speak and so do as those who will be judged by the law of liberty." And just to remind us here what was said, look back at the words of Jesus. Look back at Matthew chapter 5, please. Page 938. Matthew chapter 5, beginning of the Sermon on the Mount here again. Jesus says, "Do not think that I came to destroy the law or the prophets. I did not come to destroy, but to fulfill. For assuredly I say to you, till heaven and earth pass away, one jot or one tittle will by no means pass from the law till all is fulfilled. Whoever therefore breaks one of the least of these commandments and teaches men so shall be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever does and teaches them, he shall be called great in the kingdom of heaven." So the words of Jesus are clear. He did not come to destroy the Ten Commandments. The words of James are equally strong. Not only are Christians still called to keep the law, but if we break one, we break them all. And some people scratch their heads and say, "Boy, how is that even possible?" The answer is that keeping God's law is based upon one principle, and that one principle is the principle of love. You remember what Jesus said? "If you love me, keep my commandments." The Ten Commandment law, you'll remember, simply reveals who we love most. Do we love Jesus or do we love sin? Well, let's look again at the few verses that we read the last time that we were here together. You see it on the screen, John 14:21. "He that hath my commandments and keepeth them, he it is that loveth me. And he that loveth me shall be loved of my Father, and I will love him and will manifest myself to him." And 1 John 5, 2-3, "By this we know that we are the children of God when we love God and keep his commandments. For this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not grievous." You see, love is to be the center of our desire to keep the law, including the Sabbath commandment. And when I choose to break one commandment, no matter which one it is, I then in some way, be it big or small, work against my love relation with Christ. Now don't misunderstand. One sin is not like an on and off switch with the Lord. I mean, we know this even from human relationships. If there are two people that truly love each other and they have a deep relationship, then if one of them insults the other one, that doesn't end the relationship automatically. But if they keep it up, there may well come a day when that relationship is over. Well, the same thing is true here. We are to serve God out of love. We are to obey Him out of love. And when I choose to sin, even if it's just picking one of these commandments, you know, I says, well, this one I'm going to break. This one, I'll take care of the rest. This one I am going to break. It works against my love relationship with Jesus Christ. That's why the Bible says if we break one, we have broke them all. I mean, can you imagine if a husband and wife are married, and the man, and they've been married for a number of years, and everything seems to be going along fine, and then one day, the guy decides that he wants someone else, and so he finds this pretty girl he's attracted to, and he brings her home. Okay, this should be one of your second indications that he's not very bright, okay? So the wife objects, understandably, and says, no, no, no. And he says, come on, sweetheart, listen. I really do love you. I just want to be with my girlfriend, say, once every 10 days. And other than that, I'm going to be with you. Would he really love his wife? No, absolutely not. You know, I hope the sofa is good and comfortable, because, I mean, that's the best he's going to get out of that situation, right? Okay. Frying pan to the forehead, maybe that might be helpful at that moment. You know, he would not love his wife, no matter what his lips are saying. Oh, I love you, dear. You're the greatest, dear. He would not be honest, because she must have all of his heart, not just part of it. That is the nature of true love. You see, Christ only asks us for one thing, and that one thing is everything we've got. That's it. That's all. You say, well, that seems like a lot. Look at the cross. Look what He's given for us. And suddenly all that I have seems a very small price to pay. Very, very small. Jesus only asks us for one thing, and that one thing is everything that we've got, because when He gets all of us, He can do miraculous things in our lives. It is for our benefit that we give all of ourselves to Him. You know, just to make sure that we understand this love basis here, for keeping the Sabbath and any other commandment, take a look at page 958, Matthew 22, please. Matthew, the 22nd chapter, verse 36. Famous passage of Scripture here. Matthew 22, verse 36. Jesus, again, is having this public encounter with, among others, the religious leaders of the day. And someone says, "Teacher, which is the greatest commandment in the law?" Jesus said to him, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the first and great commandment, and the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets." In other words, if you're keeping all this stuff and there's no love, it all falls to pieces. It says, all the law and the prophets hang on these two. It's about loving Jesus. That's the source of this obedience. Now, right now might be a good time to ask, what day did Jesus keep? We're safe in following Jesus, right? Okay, I think that's fair to say. Are we safe in following Jesus Christ? Okay, all right, good, good. Just want to make sure. You see here on the screen, 1 John 2, 3-6, "And hereby we do know that we know Him, if we keep His commandments. He that saith, I know Him, and keepeth not His commandments, is a liar, and the truth is not in him." Excuse me. "But whoso keepeth His word, in him verily is the love of God perfected. Hereby know we that we are in Him. He that saith, He abideth in Him, ought himself also so to walk, even as He," Jesus, "walked." So in other words, if you love the Lord, you want to walk like Jesus walked. You want to do what Jesus did. Well, what did Jesus do when it came to the Sabbath? Luke 4, verse 16. Luke chapter 4, verse 16. This is page 994. We're keeping your fingers limbered up this evening, aren't we? Keep them limbered. There's more to come. Luke chapter 4, verse 16. The Bible's clear. Here's what it says. It says, so he came to Nazareth, this is Jesus, where he had been brought up, and as his custom was. What does that mean? This is habit, isn't it? This is what he did. This is how he lived his life, all right? And as his custom was, he went into the synagogue on the Sabbath day and stood up to read. That was his custom. It was his custom to go to church and worship on Sabbath. In fact, Jesus had so much respect for the Sabbath that looking far into the future, he asked us to respect it as well. A few pages to the left, Matthew chapter 24, verse 15. Matthew 24, verse 15. Here's what he says. It says, therefore, when you see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet standing in the holy place, whoever reads, let him understand. Then let those who are in Judea flee to the mountains. Let him who is on the housetop not go down to take anything out of his house. And let him who is in the field not go back to get his clothes. But woe to those who are pregnant and to those who are nursing babies in those days. And pray that your flight may not be in winter or on what day? On the Sabbath. Oh, there it is. Now, Jesus here is referring to the destruction of Jerusalem. And I want you to see this with your own two eyes here. Look at Luke 21. Few pages to the right, page 1019. Luke chapter 21, and let's take a look at verse 20. Jesus here speaking again, he says, but when you see Jerusalem surrounded by armies, then know that its desolation is near. Then let those who are in Judea flee to the mountains. Let those who are in the midst of her depart, and let not those who are in the country enter her. For these are the days of vengeance, that all things which are written may be fulfilled. But woe to those who are pregnant and to those who are nursing babies in those days, for there will be great distress in the land and wrath upon this people, and they will fall by the edge of the sword and be led away captive into all nations. So when Jesus says, pray that your flight away from the city will not be on the Sabbath, he's referring to the destruction of Jerusalem. Now that meant Jesus was looking 40 years into the future. We know exactly when Jerusalem was destroyed. The emperor sent General Titus and his Roman forces to surround Jerusalem in AD 70. That's when that's when they showed up around the city. And the people that were Christians in the city, they remembered, pray that your flight not be on the Sabbath. They also knew from prophecy that there would be a time when the troops would withdraw. And sure enough, the day came. It was in AD 70 in October on a Wednesday. Every last Christian got out of Jerusalem, we're told by history. Not a single one died in the destruction of that city. It's an incredible fulfillment of Bible prophecy. And Jesus here clearly says that he is expecting his people, his church, to keep the Sabbath 40 years into the future. And if that was the case, then we can be sure he wanted it to be kept to the end of time. The Sabbath is not finished at the cross, friends. It continued right on. Now take a look at Acts 13, verse 14, please. It's on page 1066. Acts chapter 13, verse 14. Which day did the disciples keep? That's an important question. You know, many people think, okay, well, you know, Jesus went to the synagogue as his custom was, but we're sure that the Christians in that first century, that they kept Sunday or some other day or no day at all. Well, let's see what the disciples did. Acts chapter 13, looking now at verse 14. It says, but when they departed from Perga, they came to Antioch in Pisidia and went into the synagogue on which day? On the Sabbath day and sat down. Now, skip over towards the end of the chapter. Look at verses 42 through 44. It says, so when the Jews went out of the synagogue, the Gentiles begged that these words might be preached to them the next Sabbath. So the apostles had preached, very well received. The Gentiles want to hear more. Verse 43, now when the congregation had broken up, many of the Jews and devout proselytes followed Paul and Barnabas, who, speaking to them, persuaded them to continue in the grace of God. On the next Sabbath, almost the whole city came together to hear the word of God. Now, understand carefully. Here we have New Testament Christians that are living under grace, keeping the seventh-day Sabbath. Acts chapter 18, verse 4, just a few more pages to the right. Acts, the 18th chapter, verse 4, page 1072, says this, and he, Paul, reasoned in the synagogue every Sabbath and persuaded both Jews and Greeks. Again, that's very clear. Paul preached every Sabbath to the Jews and the Greeks, and notice this, even without a church building to go to, the apostles would still keep the Sabbath day. We see this in Acts chapter 16, verse 13. Here's what it says. It says, "And on the Sabbath day, we went out of the city to the riverside, where prayer was customarily made, and we sat down and spoke to the women who met there." Didn't even have a church building. No excuse. We still are going to keep the Sabbath day holy in obedience to the commandment. Now, even when people see this, many sincere Christians will say, well, we keep Sunday because it is the Lord's Day. In fact, how many of you know, I mean, you've heard Sunday referred to as the Lord's Day, right? Right? I mean, it's extremely common. If someone says to you, I'm going to go to church on the Lord's Day, most everyone assumes, well, that means Sunday. But did you know that there is actually only one text in the entire Bible that has that phrase, the Lord's Day? Let's look at it. Page 1174, all the way back in Revelation chapter 1, verse 10. Revelation chapter 1, verse 10. John here is speaking. He says, "I was in the Spirit on the Lord's Day." There it is. "And I heard behind me a loud voice as of a trumpet," and then Jesus speaks to him, and the vision commences in earnest. And there it is. He says, "I was in the Spirit on the Lord's Day." Well, according to this text, since it's the only one here that we have to look at, according to this text, which day of the week is the Lord's Day? From this text, do you get that? There's nothing here, is there? It doesn't say at all. There's no mention of Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. It's not there. There's nothing there. So if we're going to find out which day is the Lord's Day, we need to look someplace else. Remember, this is the important line upon line, precept upon precept. Matthew chapter 12, verse 8, please. Matthew, the 12th chapter, looking at verse 8. Remember, the vast majority of the time, the Bible interprets itself. It may mean that we have to search a bit, but that's okay. That which we search for, we tend to remember. Jesus here is speaking. He says, "For the Son of Man," that's a reference to himself, "is Lord even of," which day? The Sabbath. Well, there it is. He is Lord of the Sabbath day, and the commandment says that the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord. You see the parallelism. Which day, according to the Bible, then, is the Lord's day? The Sabbath is, absolutely. There is no reference at all to any other day of the week. It is the seventh day Sabbath. It's very clear. Now, some people will continue on and say, you know what, it doesn't matter which particular day I keep every day holy. Now, boy, that sounds good, doesn't it? Man, I mean, this is like Christianity on steroids, right? You know, you Sabbath or Sunday or Tuesday keepers, you don't know what you're missing because every day of the week is holy to me. I mean, this is America, democracy, right? Every day should have its holiness imparted to it, apparently. And it sounds good, but here we need to be careful. Because the same commandment that says keep the seventh day holy also says that there are 6 days that we are to do what on? Labor. Oh, labor. Now, that's a problem. If you believe that every day is just as good as the next. Because the thing that is prohibited on the seventh day is labor. So you can't have them both on the same day. So if all the other 6 days are the ones on which we are to labor, and by the way, it is a command, we're supposed to do stuff, right? They can't be the Sabbath. You see, God did not say keep a Sabbath. He said keep the Sabbath. In fact, the word "the," just a little grammar lesson here. And by the way, this is true not just for English. This is true for both Hebrew and for Greek. The word "the" is what we call a definite article. It identifies a specific person, place, or thing. The Bible says the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord. It does not say that it is a Sabbath of a Lord. That doesn't make any sense at all. Either grammatically or linguistically. Friends, with all due respect, you cannot keep a day holy that God has not made holy. It cannot be done. It doesn't work that way. Let me give you a little illustration about this. Let's imagine I'm Arnold Schwarzenegger. That's going to be a stretch, I'm sure. But I'm Arnold, and I get seven large boulders, okay? And I get pumped up here, and I put number one, number two, number three, number four, number five, number six, and number seven. So I got seven boulders up here, okay? And let's say that God comes here to our meeting, and that he goes, one, two, three, four, five, six, seven, and he declares the seventh boulder to be holy, okay? Now, obviously, this is imaginary, but this, stick with me here. God makes this seventh boulder holy, okay? And then someone else hears about it, and the anti-seventh boulder alliance shows up here on our stage. And they call a committee, and they come to, let's just say, boulder number three, okay? And they come to boulder number three, and everybody lays hands on boulder number three and said, this rock is now holy, and they impart sacredness to the boulder, okay? Now, can they actually do it? No, they can't. They cannot do that. No matter what they do, no matter which boulder they pick, none of them are holy except for the seventh one. And you know what? Even if we had a series of seven boulders set up, seven here, seven here, seven here, seven here, and God said, this seventh one is holy, and this seventh one is holy, I could come to boulder number three in the first part of the first series and say, okay, I'm going to move forward seven from here. After all, God just said, you know, every 7 days. It doesn't work that way. I will skip right over the top of the only boulder that God blessed. You see, the Bible says that there is a way that seems right unto a man, but the end thereof, do you remember how it ends? The end thereof is death, Proverbs 14, verse 12. We have to be so careful when navigating in the last days. God has made ample provision for us to see the truth in his word. It's sitting right there, but so often we settle. We get complacent, and we sit back and we settle for what we've heard other people say. And say, oh, well, that seems right. Not realizing that if we were to study the word with sincerity, we would find that there is a deeper truth. I think that we need to follow God's word, not human reasoning. Can you say amen to that?
Amen.
Right. Now, there are still other sincere folk that I respect, and I've heard them say this. My guess is you probably heard this too. They will say this. They say, okay, you know, I understand what you're talking about with some of those texts there, but I believe still that it does not matter what day that I keep as a Sabbath, because the Apostle Paul himself said that it doesn't matter. Okay, now we're pulling the Bible into it, okay? To which I would gently reply, are you sure that's what he said? Most people that claim that the Bible says, specifically that Paul says, that it doesn't matter what day that you keep, it's not an issue anymore, usually they will turn to one of two texts. If they're savvy, they'll go to both of them. Colossians 2, verses 13 to 17, and Romans 14, chapter 5. Now, since we're already familiar with Colossians 2, you may recall that we were there previously. Let's take a look at this one first, but let's read a little further than we did before. It says, and you, being dead in your sins and the uncircumcision of your flesh, hath he quickened together with him. He raised us up with Jesus Christ from the grave, having forgiven you all trespasses, blotting out the handwriting of ordinances that was against us. What's that referring to? That's Moses' law. That's right, right there. Which was contrary to us, and took it out of the way, nailing it to the cross. What a picture. And having spoiled principalities and powers, he made a show of them openly, triumphing over them in it. Let no man therefore, he's going to sum it up here, let no man therefore judge you in, or with respect to, you might say, meat, or in drink, or in respect to a holy day, or of the new moon, or of the, what's it say? Sabbath days, which are a shadow of things to come, but the body or the substance is of Christ. And many people, very sincere, they'll look at this and they'll say, well, this is why. I mean, this whole talk of a seventh-day Sabbath, this is gone. It's been done away with. Paul himself makes it clear. Let's unpack this. You'll recall from what we've already seen, the Bible says there are two types of law, God's Ten Commandment law and Moses' law. But what you may not have realized in that discussion that we had previously is that this also means there are two types of Sabbaths that are mentioned in the Bible. There was the weekly seventh-day Sabbath that we've been talking about here. It's sometimes referred to in the Old Testament as the Lord's Sabbaths. And there was also, on the other hand, the ceremonial Sabbaths, also known as yearly Sabbaths. Now, the weekly Sabbath, the seventh-day Sabbath, we've already studied a lot about it this evening. It was made at creation, kept by Jesus. It was kept by the apostles both before and after Jesus' death and resurrection of Jesus. It was a memorial of God's creation of the world to be observed by Christians as long as time shall last. On the other hand, the ceremonial Sabbaths, they were tied to the earthly sanctuary system and its system of sacrifices and feasts. In fact, you may have noticed it. We breezed very quickly through it. In Leviticus 23, we're not going to look there right now. You're welcome to later. In Leviticus 23, the Feast of Trumpets, for instance, is specifically referred to as a Sabbath. That's in verse 24. The Day of Atonement, we studied about that, remember? It is also referred to as a Sabbath in verse 32. And notice carefully, they were referred to as Sabbaths even if they didn't fall on the seventh day of the week. You'll also recall that the earthly sanctuary system and all of those ceremonies that were associated with it, they all pointed forward to whom? To Christ. That's right. He was the Lamb of God that all the other lambs for hundreds of years had foreshadowed. So even though we've covered this previously, let's go ahead and let's answer a simple question. Which Sabbaths are being referred to in Colossians 3, 13 to 17? Is it the weekly Sabbaths or the ceremonial Sabbaths? What do you think? Okay, and we know that for at least two reasons. First of all, we've already made it clear in our previous study. It is Moses' law that was nailed to the cross. That's the context. Remember how important context is. That's the context of this whole passage here. It is the ceremonial law and thus refers to the ceremonial, the yearly Sabbaths. But did you know that the text itself actually comes right out and practically shouts that the seventh-day Sabbath is not being discussed here? It says, "Let no man therefore judge you in meat or in drink, or in respect to a holy day, or of a new moon, or of the Sabbath days, which are a shadow of things," what? "To come." That's extremely important. Which Sabbaths were shadows of things to come? The ceremonial ones were. Yeah, absolutely. I mean, we even talked about the Day of Atonement. It was referred to as a Sabbath. It foreshadows something that was to come in the future, that right? But what about the weekly seventh day? Did it foreshadow something to come, or did it look backward? Absolutely. It looked backward at what? At creation. Friend, this should be crystal clear. The Sabbath days that were shadows of things to come were the yearly Sabbaths contained in the ceremonial law of Moses. They were nailed to the cross. We don't observe them any longer. But the seventh-day Sabbath looked backward. It was this perpetual memorial of what God had already done in the past. Is that clear? Now, the second text that most people refer to when they say, well, Paul says it doesn't matter, is Romans chapter 14, verse 5, and the first part of verse 6. Let's take a look at that. Page 1090. Romans chapter 14. Beginning with verse 5. It says here, "One person esteems one day above another. Another esteems every day alike. Let each be fully convinced in his own mind." First part of verse 6, "He who observes the day observes it to the Lord, and he who does not observe the day to the Lord, he does not observe it." Now, notice what people will draw out of this, and I can understand. I mean, if this is all that I read, I would probably draw the same conclusion. What Paul is saying here is, if you think the Sabbath ought to be on the seventh day, that's fine. If you think it ought to be on the first day, that's fine. The important thing is that everyone is convinced in their own mind, okay? And if one person doesn't observe it like you think they should, that's okay, because they are being faithful to their understanding of the Lord. That's usually the line of reasoning that people pull out of this text. But I would gently ask, is this really what the text is saying? Well, to find out, we need to note several things. First of all, sometimes it is helpful to note what a text doesn't say as well as what it does. So look carefully. Does verse 5 and 6 say anything about either worship or Sabbath? It's not there. You see, people will come to this text, and often we take our preconceived notions and we just kind of inject them in there to the text. The Sabbath is nowhere under discussion. Worship is nowhere under discussion here. It's simply not there. To say that this particular day that's being referred to is the seventh-day Sabbath is an unwarranted assumption. Now, notice also, number two, context, as we have said, is extremely important. And so if we want the context of this chapter, we probably ought to scout around a little bit. In fact, look at verse 1, Romans 14, verse 1. Paul here sets the stage for the entire discussion in chapter 14. He says, "Receive one who is weak in the faith, but not to disputes over doubtful things." Now you tell me, is the seventh-day Sabbath that was set apart by God at creation, placed within the heart of the Ten Commandment law, observed by Jesus Christ, observed by his apostles, both before and after Jesus' death and resurrection, and continued to be observed by Christians throughout all of that first century and well beyond, is that a doubtful thing? No. The Bible has clearly established it. We've seen text after text that establishes the truth of God's Ten Commandment law, and the fourth is right in the heart of that. Which leads us to a third point. The key to understanding this passage is further context found in verse 6. Let's read verses 5 and 6, actually, and this time let's read all of verse 6. Paul says, "One person esteems one day above another. Another esteems every day alike. Let each be fully convinced in his own mind." Verse 6, "He who observes the day observes it to the Lord, and he who does not observe the day to the Lord, he does not observe it. He who eats to the Lord, for he gives God thanks, and he who does not eat to the Lord, he does not eat and gives God thanks." Now that's a little odd, isn't it? Why is Paul matching up so closely this esteeming of a day with talk about eating food? Well, I'm going to give you a hint. There are zero food restrictions attached to the seventh day Sabbath. None. But there were man-made food restrictions regarding man-made fast days. You know what it means to fast, right? It doesn't mean to drive quickly. Okay, it means to not have any food, right? That we cease from food. That is a fast day. You see, the issue in Romans 14 is not the Sabbath day, but fast days. Some Jewish Christians believed that there was particular merit in fasting in certain days, and then they would judge other people by their own standard. The Pharisees, in fact, fasted at least twice a week, and they crowed like roosters about it, as Jesus himself pointed out. You can read about that in Luke 18, verses 11 and 12. In Romans 14, therefore, Paul is pointing out that to fast or not to fast on a certain day is a matter of individual conscience and not a matter of God's command. That's what the context here clearly says. The seventh-day Sabbath is not even under discussion. Now, even when people see that line of reasoning, they say, okay, let's say that I grant you that the seventh-day Sabbath is clearly taught in Scripture. Many people will sincerely come back and they'll say, the progression of days throughout time has been mixed up. And we no longer know what day the actual Sabbath is. In fact, some will say, you know, the calendar was changed. Now, you see what the reasoning is. There's been too much time, too much chaos throughout the millennia that the human history has been going on here, and we can't possibly know that the seventh day, for instance, that Jesus kept is the same seventh day that we're keeping today. And by the way, wasn't the calendar changed? Well, I think there are two equally valid responses to this. Number one, if that objection is true, then Sunday is wrong as well. It's a double-edged sword, isn't it? If we say we can't know, then Sunday or any other day doesn't have any merit either, because if we can't know, we can't know for any day, not just the seventh. Secondly, the charge of time somehow being lost is simply not true. There is absolutely zero credible evidence for such a loss, period. So if you think that time has been lost, I invite you. The burden of proof lies with you. It is up to you to prove your point, because no one else has even come close to doing so. It's simply not there. No time has been lost. In fact, if you're really curious, Go home tonight. You can look up on the computer. Look up the NIST. That's the National Institute of Standards and Technology. And the U.S. Naval Observatory. These are the civilian and military entities, respectively, that deal with time standards. They will tell you, you can look at their websites, do some research there. They will tell you clearly that no time has been lost, for instance, between the time of Christ, who clearly kept the seventh-day Sabbath, and our day. Zero, zip, none. No time has been lost. But there was a calendar change, a one-time calendar change in 1582 by Pope Gregory XIII. But it did not affect the weekly cycle of days one bit. Here's what happened. You know, we currently use, if you have a wall calendar, does anybody use a wall calendar anymore? Okay, all right, got some analog folk here. That's good. Keep going. Digital is nipping at your heels, isn't it? What we use currently today is the Gregorian calendar. You probably knew that. You probably told your wife, look, dear, there's our Gregorian calendar on the wall. Prior to the Gregorian calendar, the Julian calendar was used from about 46 BC onward. That calendar had the length of a year being 365 days and 6 hours. Anybody sense a problem with that? It was a problem. Because, you see, this was 11 minutes more than it was supposed to be. And over the years, those 11 minutes accumulated, and by 1582, the calendar was approximately 10 days out of harmony with the solar system. Now, you understand that, right? I mean, the changing of the seasons, you're expecting things to warm up, and hey, the calendar's 10 days off. What's the big deal? We got to get this thing fixed. And so to fix it, something had to be done. On Thursday, you see it here on the screen, on Thursday, October 4, 1582, the next day should have been October the 5th, a Friday, but instead they decided it would become October 15. The flow of the days of the week were not affected at all, only the dates. Do you understand that? You see that? You see it here on the screen? It was supposed to be October 5, Friday, but instead they say, okay, we're going to get these 10 days out of here because we got to make this right and make the year end appropriately. So it went 1, 2, 3, 4, October 15, 16, 17. But the progression of days remained unchanged. Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday. That all stayed the exact same way as it had been before. You know, we make adjustments like this as well today. What do we call it? Leap year. That's right. We do it February 29. Always feel sorry for people that have their birthday on that day. They age a quarter the speed that we do, but they get a quarter the birthday parties as well. Isn't it terrible? Okay. Now, speaking of the calendar, it is a fact that in 108 languages of the world today, the seventh day, Saturday, is called Sabbath. It's fascinating. It's not just confined to one language or two languages or a dozen, 108 of them. And thus, there should be no question that the Sabbath day today is exactly the same seventh-day Sabbath that Jesus kept while he was on this earth. Now, even here, some people will still say, they say, we keep Sunday in honor of what event? The resurrection. I think it's probably one of the most common things that's said. We keep Sunday in honor of the resurrection. And I agree, that is a well-intended thought. But we need to respectfully ask, is it biblical? Is it biblical? You see, God did give two things to honor: his death, his burial, and his resurrection. First of all, he gave communion service and said, do this in remembrance of me. Secondly, he gave baptism. But this was a memorial, not a new Sabbath. In fact, nowhere in Scripture is it found that Sunday worship is to replace Sabbath worship, much less be a new memorial to the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Now, we're going to talk more about that in our second session this evening. But for now, I hope that this is clear. From Genesis to Revelation and from Eden to the second coming, there has always been and always will be a Sabbath. From creation, all throughout the Old Testament, the Sabbath was kept. And then Jesus, in the four Gospels, he kept the Sabbath day and clearly indicated that the Sabbath would go on beyond the crucifixion. The early Christians in the New Testament kept it. Paul himself kept it. And as if that weren't enough, Revelation 14, as we read in that first angel's message, it makes it clear that the Sabbath is a specific issue at the end of time. And thus the message is clear. The Sabbath is forever and always to be kept by those who trust and love Jesus. Now, after disturbing you with a study like this, I think it is important to tell you clearly who, when, and by what authority the Sabbath was changed. Let's go once again to that prophecy in Daniel that describes the Antichrist power. Take a look at Daniel chapter 7, verse 25. Some big pieces of the puzzle should be falling into place for you here. And I know that this is challenging. I know that this may be new. It may be difficult. But hang in there, hang in there. Daniel 7:25, speaking of that little horn, Antichrist power, it says, "He shall speak pompous words against the Most High, shall persecute the saints of the Most High, and shall intend to change times and law." God here has identified the papal power as the one that is going to change times and laws. Interestingly enough, the only law in the Ten Commandments that deals with times is found in the fourth commandment. Remember the Sabbath day. That's a unit of time, isn't it? 6 days, there it is again, shalt thou labor. The seventh day is the Sabbath. For in 6 days the Lord made and rested on the seventh day. The Lord blessed the Sabbath day. God is simply telling us here that we should not be surprised to find that the papacy is responsible for changing times, particularly changing laws, particularly ones dealing with time. Now, we're going to see more evidence for that in session number 2 tonight. But for now, let's read from a Catholic catechism and see if this is indeed so. You see it here on the screen. You might be able to make it out there. This is the Convert's Catechism of Catholic Doctrine, page 50. They use a question and answer format that's fairly common in a number of catechisms that have been written over the years. Question, what is the third commandment? And which commandment would this be in your seminar Bible? This would be number 4. You recall that the papacy took out one of the earlier commandments because it talked about not making a graven image or bowing down to it. That was not something that they were interested in, and so they took it out of the Ten Commandments. And so now the numbering is one notch down. So what is the third commandment? Answer, the third commandment is, remember that thou keep holy the Sabbath day. Next question, what is the Sabbath? Which is the Sabbath day? Answer, Saturday is the Sabbath day. Question, why do we observe Sunday instead of Saturday? Answer, we observe Sunday instead of Saturday because the Catholic Church transferred the solemnity from Saturday to Sunday. Now, sadly, that's pretty clear, isn't it? My hope is that these issues are becoming quite clear to you. Let's sum it up here. On one side is Antichrist and the commandments of humans. On the other side is Jesus Christ and his commandments. And Jesus says, gently, if you love me, keep my commandments. Friends, again, I want to say that I know that this study can be disturbing like few others can be. I want to urge you to come back for our second session. Don't grab an hors d'oeuvre and head for the door, please. There are such good things here in session number 2. There's probably some questions that you have. We're going to talk about, my guess is, I'm going to anticipate a number of those here in our second session. I want you to remember that any place that Jesus takes us, we can safely go. If Jesus is leading here this evening in our discussion, we can safely follow him, no matter where he takes us. Let's pray. Jesus, I thank you that we can trust you. You proved your character beyond doubt at Calvary when you gave your life for us. We thank you for the gift of salvation. We thank you for the changed heart that you give to us, Lord, that longs to follow you, to obey you. I pray that you would give us insight, wisdom, Lord, and perhaps most of all, courage to ask and answer the hard questions, Lord. May we come to know you as it is our purpose to know you. For we ask it in your name. Amen.